Hello, Mike Troy with Retail Leader here at the Symphony Retail AI Accelerate Conference in Irving, Texas. I'm joined by Andy Harris.
Hello.
Good to see you. So, Shopper Experience Insights. Mm-hmm. You've got an interesting solution here. We were talking a little bit about it.
Yep.
Kind of like the two key use cases here being brand owners, but then also retailers that are developing formats and new concepts. Walk me through a little bit about like the problem you're solving here for companies.
Sure.
And how this actually works.
Sure. Well, what we're looking at here is a solution to address the issue of new product introductions. Obviously, 80% of new product introductions usually fail within the first year. What we're trying to do here is to generate some insights to understand how people engage with these new items, these new store layouts, new shopper marketing approaches, before we actually put them out into store. So it's about shopper experience and shopper mm-hmm. engagement. Shopper experience, of course, is a crucial thing in brick and mortar environments at the moment, because of course we want to engage people, bring them out off the couch and the sofa to interact with the stores themselves. So this allows CPG companies and retailers to evaluate new concepts and the emotional engagement that they generate with the customers before they actually launch them.
And how does that work? Because I see their little picture of you here and it's capturing your emotional state.
Yeah. So what we're actually seeing here, we take a number of different feeds and information elements here, including conscious surveys, 3D store information, etc. But what we're looking at here is our emotional approach. So what we're looking at is something which gives us the ability to be able to track the respondents' emotions to the stimulus that they're seeing. So what's actually happening, this is what happens behind the scenes. Mm-hmm. So the respondents don't see this, but we then send out a survey to a quantitative panel, 1,000 people plus, and we give them some different examples of in-store stimulus. And they could be anything from stills to interactive 3D walkthroughs to shoppability environments.
And I know privacy is a big deal. So people opt in, they know that they're being their emotions are being captured.
That's correct.
Via webcam.
Everything is completely GDPR compliant in Europe, and there's no PII information being saved. Even though we're seeing the respondent here, we're not actually capturing any information.
Okay.
From in terms of my face information, nothing that will actually identify myself to anyone else. What we're capturing is the emotional stimulus that I'm getting from the items that you're seeing on the right-hand side and the survey itself.
Now, so how does capturing that emotional stimulus help me not fail as a new product?
So it's another stream of information to understand the efficacy of the items that you're launching. Obviously, you can track how people buy things and what the intended purchase is going to be. But what we can do here is understand the engagement with the product or the launch items that we're putting together. In this particular instance, we're looking at different produce environments and trying mm-hmm. to understand from this environment which of these generate more positive emotional reactions to the supermarkets, to the stimulus you're seeing here.
Section of produce here, like what would you be looking to analyze based on this?
So we are looking for things like price information. We're looking at the overall visual merchandising effect. We're looking at any promotions that we have on there, the quality of the product that's on display. And we're using all those as stimuli to be able to understand the responses to the customers. So alongside this stimulus here, we then ask physical questions about what you've just seen.
Okay.
So we can get some conscious responses to what you've seen as well. And we can match those conscious responses with the unconscious responses that I've actually generated through my emotional response.
So then the ability to capture that visual mm-hmm. emotion
yeah.
then also works for me as a retailer.
Mm-hmm.
If I've got I'm resetting a store or changing a design.
Yes.
You can see how I'm reacting to that as well.
Exactly, and we use that in combination with things like eye tracking as well mm-hmm. to be able to understand what people are looking at in store. But here we're looking at specifically different emotional types, but also what we term valence and arousal. So how engaged people
are. I'm
sorry,
what was that?
So this is looking at different valence and arousal.
What is valence?
So that's kind of the, valence and arousal are two different emotional responses.
Okay.
Valence is about whether you like something or not, frankly.
Okay.
And arousal is how engaged and excited you are with it.
Well, yeah, we know I'm aroused right now talking about this solution.
I mean, who wouldn't be? Who wouldn't
yes,
be? It's
exactly.
kind of like when you watch horror films, for instance,
right.
you know, you may be getting a very strong emotional response,
okay.
but you may not enjoy the experience.
Okay.
So if I'm getting a very excited response, high arousal, but I don't like watching horror movies, I've got negative valence. So that actually gives us the ability to look at different degrees of emotion through that particular stimulus. Now we're applying that type of technology to stimulus in supermarkets. So that could be specifically for new items, because of course new items are when you start disrupting the shelf, because you're adding new packaging designs, you're adding new subcategories into the environment itself. You might be adding a whole new niche subsection to your planogram and display. And you may be supporting that with different emotional responses as well, different emotional calls to action. So shopper marketing, activation, signage, pricing information, all of that type of stuff. And what we're looking to do with this is to track how your emotions are responding to that. And use that to be able to then not just look at shoppability, but also the engagement of the customer with that particular item, with that particular offer. It's another stream that we can look at to try and quantify the effect of the environment in store.
And you just help me make easier, better decisions so I don't make the wrong decision.
Absolutely. So our CPG partners are using this to be able to validate the items that they're putting together, their offers, to be able to create better business cases, to be able to go to their retailer partners to introduce these items. Because they can say that this new item that we're launching engages with customers when we put it in this planogram as opposed to this one, in this part of the store as opposed to something else.
Yeah.
So it's not just about simply are people buying, it's also about what are the emotional cues which are causing them to convert their purchase.
And then if I'm designing a store, it also would help me avoid making a bad choice about putting a fixture this way instead of that way.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
So when we're using it with retailer companies or people who are looking to create specific new concept, new next generation retailing environments, for instance, then we can use this together with our eye tracking scenarios to be able to see what people are seeing in this new store concept, what's emotionally engaging with them within the stores itself. And it's a very quick turnaround process to be able to generate this type of insight for stores that haven't necessarily even been built
right.
yet.
Are you able to use it for analyzing people's emotions about, like, let's say I'm redesigning my website and I want to make sure I don't, you know, if I put some product over here versus over there? Are you there yet on the...
So that's not been a key focus for us at the moment.
Are you getting a bigger reaction from brands or retailers?
So far it's brands. Okay. Not to say it's not of interest and use for retailers, but CPG companies obviously are launching lots of new products throughout the course of the year. I was speaking to a customer earlier on, said they're launching around about 70 or 80 products during the course of the year. Now that is a high turnover, lots of value, lots of money actually riding on those successful implementations. So we're seeing that CPG companies especially are able to use this to be able to influence that side of
You know who else is introducing a lot of new products is retailers' own brands.
Absolutely, yeah.
A lot of major food retailers are up to 30% penetration with private brands.
Totally.
So there could be like a use case both ways, store design and...
Yeah, very much.
Products.
I mean, private label is kind of the CPG company within the retailer almost. So being able to understand the impact of those, especially when there's going to be a direct comparison against the brand leader or whether you're comparing against if you're a value label, trying to compare against like a tertiary or secondary line. Being able to then do those spot checks and focused analysis of how does my new product extension for this private label, how does it compare against the brand leader? Are we going to be able to encourage people to switch from the brand leader to the private label and maximize that? So it's kind of poacher turn game catcher, a keeper, I suppose, for private label teams as well as CPG companies.
What was that? Poacher?
Poacher turn gamekeeper, yeah. It's
okay.
It's a UK expression. So it's using your skills in one area to be able to then flip to the other side and use it in that experience as well. So there you go. That's one for the US market.
All right, I'll remember that one. Okay. Thanks, Andy.
Pleasure.
All right.